and we want to know what it's capable of. And what does it know? So now we went from joking to now want to write an essay or want to write a kid's book, a children's book. And we made a theme as how can we get kids to spend less time on screen? Yeah. Have you been playing with ChatGPT?
I absolutely love it. So when it first came out, when I first heard about it and I play with it, like the moment I found it, I think it was like a day or two behind when it was released. I immediately thought about Star Trek and I thought about, so this is a text to computer interface rather than saying computer generate the visual graphic of these three data points and plot it over the course of the system or like however the heck they're using like computers. Cause the computer human interface is ubiquitous and it's fully voice automated and fully like all the sensors and everything like that. And I said, this is one step. This is the first step in being able to use something that's quicker that can add and digest larger pieces of information than any human can. And I've always been really in love with just the tool and the idea of smoother, higher utility software. We have a lot of software that is very niche, not always very high utility. You know, I think about the fight of, I'm not a big fan of blockchain. So I'm not a big fan of NFTs. I understand the reason for crypto. I love the tech, but the utility wasn't there. I always thought, for instance, that for the blockchain, I thought a really good use for blockchain would be deed ownership. Yeah. So you have everybody in the country basically has a slice of what everybody else owns. And not a slice, but more like it's staked. So I know that my deed is here because everybody else says that my deed is here. Yeah. And I thought as a use case for moving through and creating a shared, like a distributed receipt, like a distributed ledger, which is what the blockchain, its promise, I was like, oh, that's a really good way to do that. And then whatever that ubiquitous piece of tech is, for us, it's a phone. The phone is part of what you would use as the stake. So proof of stake. So one of the great things about proof of stake is that in order to change the ownership, which is a really good use case for liens and for deeds, all of the pieces that have are pointing to that person or that entity's ownership of that thing, all of them have to change. So it's very difficult to break, very difficult to hack, which is the purpose. I found that some of the other stuff, you know, while we're talking about ChatGPT, there's also generative AI art. So something that happened very recently within the past couple of weeks was an artist created board monkeys and just started like, and so it just, because the AI in this generative model is increasing and accelerating the speed of execution.
Yeah.
The speed of research, the speed of first draft, the speed of art creation. And so part of it is like, yes, we're losing some elements. Some people are going to be out of work in a certain way. But the nature of the work will shift. There's a new discipline that's coming up called prompt engineering, which I'm loving, which is like, how do you communicate with the AI in such a way that you get the result that you want every time?
Yeah.
So bring it on. bring on the medical nanites. Go ahead.
It's interesting that, you know, I've been playing with it quite a bit, and it's essentially a productivity tool. And it's just all of us now has infinite number of assistants that help us in the creative process. So which is, you know, was very fascinating to see that that's like the first, you know, role that gets taken out when everybody was expecting like the blue collar, the repetitive work that's going to be taken out first, but now we're going for the creative. But when you think about it, it's really not the creative concept, the creative piece that's being taken out. It's the production piece of the creative part. So you have essentially on your phone, you have a team of ideation, and you have a team that can create an outline. You have a team that can give you different formats for the same outline. You can get a first draft, and the beauty is to essentially be the director and be the producer. It can help you with direction. It can help you produce, but you have to have the vision. And you have to be able to articulate that vision in a format and a prompt that will give you the result you want. And it's and I love that, because I've always been that person that had so many ideas but didn't have the skills. And I drown in ideas. They don't have the skills to actually produce, you know, whether it is in text or in graphic. And I have this tool that I actually can sit with it for, you know, a day, and I can write a full, you know, I can write a book, I can write a blog, I can write a sales copy. You can write an outline for videos. And it's just amazing. And I just love that. I love that. That's just just the ability to do all those things.
There were a lot of other utility as well, just to kind of add on here, because I think it's very common for fathers to sometimes teach specific skills to their kids. I actually wrote web callers. I had ChatGPT write code for me. So I had little projects. It's kind of like, oh, I know I want this kind of data. I wanted to have something that would scan Twitter for certain keywords and certain personalities and just kind of do a mass scan of the API and just give me like high performing tweets and high performing ideas and stuff like that. And ChatGPT basically made me a Python script for it. So it's wow. Like, there's this, I bring up code because in like, I was a game designer for 10 years and it was a data manipulation and the thought process was something that was good, but I wasn't always great at creating the code for it.
Yeah.
But nowadays today it's like, I was talking with he's still in the industry. He's a design director. And I was saying, you know, what's really awesome right now is that I know what I want to create. I have the vision for these games. Like if I sat down for a weekend, I could literally probably code it. And I know a little bit about generating the art, I can create my own assets.
Yeah. So
with some effort, I can literally make my own game in a weekend. Yes. Like a functional game that I want to play that I've always wanted to play.
Yeah.
And that's, so this unlock, as you're saying, of realizing the vision to the execution, I'm like, bring it on. There's so many people that have, we have a belief here, as a personal brand strategist, that it's not the best idea that wins in the world. It's the team that has the most sophistication that it ends up winning, and part of sophistication is the ad buy. It's a larger discussion, but overall the idea is that the person that can afford the click and create the desire and is the best marketer kind of gets the click. But now there's a mechanism for people that have really great ideas to get them out fast.
Yes.
And that's the part I think is like amazing. Cause like,
yes,
there's people that are really good orators and they can't write. But now they can just talk and they can write the essay. And it's just, I don't know. Like, I feel like it's, and what's so amazing is that we think it's so powerful now. Like, we think like already there's this huge unlock. Like, in 5 years, it's not going to be recognizable. Like, the unlock that's going to happen in society for this, especially if we're able to roll it out and fix some of the ethical issues with some of the copyright infringement and stuff like that. And like, it's just going to be like this huge societal change in the same way that the internet did. It's like, I liken this to the internet. This is like we haven't had a major unlock, maybe social media, maybe, since then, but what happened yesterday is, Microsoft announced the Bing roll.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So the Bing and GPT-4. So it's the model, the next model after what ChatGPT is.
Yeah.
Is being,
what was the day before?
Bing.
So it was Wednesday. That happened Wednesday. And then Google came on Thursday and brought in Bart. Yeah.
Yes.
And which was fascinating, and you appreciate it as a marketer. And essentially the articles that came out, all the articles came out as Google announces that their ChatGPT rival. So essentially ChatGPT owns the category now, because now it's the name of the, you know, of the tool and of the ability to prompt something into. So, and I think what's powerful about the Bing is because ChatGPT, we know, has information up to 2021. So it's not like it doesn't have a live feed to the internet. Bing has a live feed. So it actually can give you today's information, which is now, I'm like, I saw that yesterday and I'm like, man, I'm going to go back and start playing with Bing now.
It's Microsoft, like that first mover's advantage, like,
yes,
they capitalize. I forget. Forgive me, CEO, for not remembering your name. You are an important historical figure at this moment in time. I can see him. I can see him. But he did very well by making that move.
And, Microsoft CEO.
Yeah. Yes.
Oh. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I can't remember his name either. Yes.
Just a fantastic move. Just a great foresight. When I think about the application of this technology as a father.
Yes.
Right, I think about, okay, so my eldest daughter is going into sixth grade. So she has a certain age. And I'm like, all right, this summer, I'm sitting her down and teaching her everything that I know. And I'm just going to be like, all right, so I want to unlock for you this AI technology, because I want you to do this, because I know that by the time she hits the workforce, in the same way that we kind of have today, we have kids that grew up recording videos and uploading it to YouTube, that we have the coders, like the programmers today, like the young ones that are like in the 25 to 30, they've been coding their whole life.
Yeah.
Like since they've been able to type, like since they were like 10. So like it's just those decades of iterations on the skill. And I'm like, you know what? I think that this interface with AI, I truly believe that there's going to be two elements. There's going to be the idea of knowing what's out in the world. So the experience that I have, the experience that you have as the father, we can't replicate that. We have seen the advent of the internet. We've seen the different kinds of work and stuff like that. We've seen job categories go away, like completely go away. So we understand a little bit. We have a little bit more of a older, wiser view of the world that can't be imparted. But I think we can see as fathers the foresight of like this technology, it's important. This skill set to develop, being able to interface with an AI in a way to generate the response you want, that's going to be huge. And I don't care about all that nonsense about cheating and writing the essays. It's kind of like, great, then I teach my daughter not to have her write the essay and have her write the outline.
Yeah.
Like,
well, one thing that I'm doing, so I have a 7 and a 9-year-old, and actually I make it like it's a daily thing for them to interact with the tools. And one of the things that we started, so conceptually to begin from the beginning, is the concept of prompting, which is asking for what you want. Just by itself, it's a concept that's universal for me. And I always think, you know, if you don't know what you want, you know, you might get it. So it's, you know what I mean? So be careful, you might get it. So I always talk to them about, you know, kind of like thinking about what they're thinking to articulate what they want, you know, out of the world. So if they're going to ask me for something, or they're going to ask the universe for something, or if they're going to communicate their emotion, you know, figure out what's bothering you and what do you want to go away? What do you want to get out of something? So conceptually, just that principle by itself, to be able to articulate in one sentence what you want from the world, what you want from a situation, what you want from another person is super powerful. And then the next layer of it is the ability to interact with the artificial intelligence. And one of the exercises that we started playing with, you know, at first it was just it was just prompting it around making jokes. And so Jack, you know, my 7-year-old, he's a joker and he loves to, you know, mess around. So he said, all right, let's ask ChatGPT to write us a joke about, you know, french fry. And so we asked it for, so now the next thing is, we asked ChatGPT what kind of jokes does it know? And so he gave us a list of all the types of jokes it knows. And then we went, you know, one by one to understand, you know, what's a riddle joke? What's a knock knock joke? What's this for that French fry? And then so we went through that exercise and then it said, okay, what's a dark kind of comedy joke? You know, what's a dark humor? All these different types. So that took us to another space where now we have ChatGPT as an assistant that we just hired. And we want to know what it's capable of. You know, what does it know? So now I'm constantly like, we went from joking to now want to write an essay or want to write a kid's book, a children's book. And we made a theme as how can we get kids to spend less time on screen? So my kids don't spend any time on screen. And one of the things that we found in our neighborhood, we live in this great neighborhood. It's a beautiful neighborhood, great families. But there are a lot of girls and not that many boys. And the very few boys that exist in our neighborhood, they're like, my daughter has like 25 friends and there are only two boys out of 27 kids. And but those two boys are constantly playing video games and they would rather stay inside playing with their tablets than come outside and play. The girls are outside, but the boys are just staying in. So I'm trying to get these boys to come out. So we said, okay, let's write like a kid's children's book about the benefits of being outside and the negatives of being on screen. And then we asked ChatGPT. And then so we said, what kind of writing does it know? You know, so we kind of figured out what categories of children's books exist. So from fiction to fantasy to all these things. Now my kids know what categories of writing exist. And then now within those styles, what kind of tones can we go? Can we go with, with a scary tone? Can we go with a humorous tone? Can we go with a super exciting, active tone? And then so Isabel took fantasy. Jack wanted more of a funny humor, you know, kind of like a Home Alone type story. And so, and then we created the characters and then we created like a storyline. We created the bad guys and the good guys and all this. It was fascinating. And then as it given us these different give us an outline and then give us examples. And then we kept kind of going deeper and deeper, asking it to make it more exciting and more dangerous and more this. And it was fascinating to see the kids interact with it in a way that it was very intuitive. But we're constantly iterating and asking ourselves, what do we want? How do we want to feel from this story? And then asking the tool to create that, which is like marvelous.
There is so much that is rich and amazing and awe-inspiring just from that story. The fact that, you know, as a former video game developer, I'm just blown away at the pure level of making knowledge and creation and things that are hard fun.
Yeah.
Like it was fun. They were engaged. It was immersive. They got immediate feedback. They did all the things that we do very well in video games on, quite frankly, what is a purple, gray, and white screen.
Yes.
That's what ChatGPT. I have dark mode on. I always have dark mode on, but like a white, gray, or white and black screen. Like,
yeah.
we've been talking about as a society, how can we get people off the screens? How we can do this? How we get them off video games? How we can do that? And it's kind of like, but when I was a kid, I used to play text-based video games and I used to play adventure games in Sierra and I used to have to figure out and piece together how to construct this. And the consequence was usually, you know, 5 to 10 minutes of time. Like if you lose in a game, you're losing time basically.
Yeah.
But with ChatGPT, it's like the consequence is like, oh, you just have to go back a couple steps.
Yeah.
You know, you might have to restart because you can recreate it or redo a thing. And it's just very just organic play. Right.
Yes.
That's what gaming is about. That's what knowledge acquisition should be about. And I feel like you can, I would love to see the societal upgrades of this organic learning creation thing. Like you can write a storybook in 5 minutes. You can create. You can learn absolutely everything you need to know and create a new fictional story about any single event in history that the system would know about.
Like, yeah.
It's mind-bogglingly optimistic. I love it.
Yes. Well, I think it's very empowering. It will elevate and accelerate the creation. It will allow for the crappy work that relies on ads and relies on push, you know, to kind of get pushed aside, and what true creativity, what true real good products, real tools to elevate themselves, because now they'll be able to be created and they'll be able to be easier to iterate and it'll be easier to push out. I think it's going to elevate the standard of what's possible. Like we were talking, my wife and I were talking about this morning, and we were saying, you know, it would be really cool if ChatGPT, a format of Bing, for example, as a browser, empowered with ChatGPT would actually kind of learns from you. So you have a profile and it learns who you are. Maybe it goes and grabs existing information on you, kind of creates a profile of who you are. And then with your interactions, it learns your values. And then now essentially you can have a personalized, based on you and your values experience of the internet. And it's almost like it takes your consciousness, it takes your personality and your values, and then it gives it access to all the information in the world, and then it allows your kid to interact with all the tools and the information through your own family values, your own personal values, as opposed to, you know, keeping everything open out there. There's a little filter, if you will, through your own, you know, because now moving forward, our browsing experience is going to completely change. We're not going to be going clicking on links anymore. It will just give you the answer, and then that answer, and eventually ChatGPT, now it's not following it probably is, but eventually it's going to know who you are, and it's going to know how you think, and it's going to know, and it's going to grab other information that's already existing on social media and on dating sites and on, you know, driving records and all that stuff, banking in there, to actually give you the answer that you really want, that personalized, you know, answer. And so if you're able to teach it how you think, and you prompt it the right way, and based on your history and based on your behavior, it will actually give you the good answer. We're talking about, so my wife kind of had a problem with that for a little bit. And then I said, and I changed the subject that I did. I changed it from, for example, an AI empowered Yelp, for example. So I was telling her, imagine that instead of me looking at restaurants, we're going to go on Valentine's Day dinner, for example. And instead of me looking at restaurants that, you know, we're on a diet right now, and we're trying to eat keto and healthy. So I need to find a restaurant that is like a great vibe for Valentine's or for a couple, a great date vibe. I want something with a view. I want something that has healthy food, doesn't have a lot of carbs, and more like a keto-ish type diet. And I want something that's available that I actually can get a reservation at. So if I can just tell the, instead of me looking, and I want it within a certain budget, because I don't want to spend $500 for two people. I want a certain budget. So if I can tell, prompt it that way, and then the Yelp will come back and says, hey, you know, there are these two restaurants that fit what you're looking for. And this one has more availability at 5 p.m. dinner, and this one doesn't have availability until 6. And you know, and then this one has the Brussels sprouts that Jen likes, and this one has the ribeye that you like. Therefore, I'm gonna, you know what I mean? I'm gonna pick one of them, and I say, okay, go ahead and make a reservation. And then what if it actually goes even a step further and actually reads my calendar, and it knows that I want to go on the Valentine's Day on the 25th. Not on the 14th, and says, hey, by the way, you know, there are these three restaurants that fit what you usually like and what you're going through right now. And they're going to get busy by the right now. How about we make a reservation in December so we can have a table, and because they book up pretty quickly. And, you know, you know what I mean? So there's so many things that the tool, Yelp has the data. Yelp has my past behavior data, has my geo-targeting data where I was, has all these things, has my reviews, has the, you know, I've given it all the information, but it's still not smart. It's still dumb. And with an AI upgrade, I think it will be amazing to have that experience.
As I was listening to you, I was just reflecting on how soon. I was like, Google's rolling out their thing. I bet in a couple months it'll be there. And it's the thing that I love so much about AI. It's so much faster. Like it's just so much faster at the iterations. And like we're going to see that, I think the term is the technology singularity, right?
Like
we're seeing that acceleration of the improvement in the tech and the improvement of the software and stuff like that.
Yes.
I love this idea. I love the idea of like this thing actually becoming useful again. Like if it becoming this thing that can be like, oh, hey, you know, just a reminder, it's such and such time. You haven't left your office yet, but you need to go eat because you have Taekwondo tonight. Like, that would be immediately useful. Like a real assistant being like, get out of the phone's been in the room for this much time, you know? Like,
Like
something like that. That would be amazing.
It's not hard. Now you think it's not hard to do. You know what I mean? It knows your calendar. It knows where you've been before. You tell it what your goals are. It knows even your goals. It knows what your, you know, all your health things. It probably knows when you're hungry, or it knows when you're tired. it's amazing.
I think even your idea of just saying this is the diet. So like, you know, I've done a major, even for me personally, I've done a major protein change. So I think 50% of my plate is protein now, and I've drastic reduction in carbs, drastic reduction in carbs and sugar.
Yeah.
And I've seen inches off. So it's, everything's working. Everything's doing what I need it to do from that perspective. But it would be really nice, you know, to have the AI from all this behavior learn, these are the kinds of foods I like to buy. And so I could just do the real thing. Like the real upgrade for me would be like, hey, AI, I want to buy groceries again. Or like I'm heading to the grocery store. And then in the time it takes me to get to the grocery store, I pull up the list. And then so that would be first level upgrade. The next level upgrade would be by the time I get to the grocery store, the bagger has already pre-purchased everything and I can just kind of walk up and pick up my bags and then go home. Next level upgrade is like I hit the button and then like within a couple hours it's at my doorstep.
Yeah.
Right. And I don't even have to interact with it. I can maybe do a curation of the list, but it, as you're saying, it's doing things that computers are innately built to do. They're built to look at patterns. They're built to connect data. They're built to execute fast. They don't have to have the creativity and that kind of stuff, or establish the vision, or think into the future, or just build a relationship and emote. It doesn't have to have that. Anything that the computer can generate in you as far as an emotional response, it's not conscious of that. you've told it you want that. There's no difference between that and a director that works with a really great music composer, that when you're watching the scene in the movie or the TV show, the score comes in and it evokes the emotion. There's no difference than that. Right.
Yeah.
And it's all just these patterns, and there's always going to be, and here's the only concern I ever hear. There's always the concern of, but is it getting rid of the human creation? No, because human beings have craftsmanship, and there's a specific feeling. And when you look at different painters and you look at different, like, I worked in video games, I know what artists look like. It's like, I know what they can create, and they all have a style and they all have an expression. There's a mood and an emotion with what they create. Sure. Go ahead.
It's interesting that you said that, because there's a lot of concern around the copyrights and all that stuff. And then, the tools right now, especially the Midjourneys and the creative tools right now, essentially they're merging all these different styles and all these different the art that's already existing. And isn't that what artists have always done? If you take an artist and you spend, a month sitting at the Louvre, they're going to go home and they can create, it's their own style, but it's going to be based on all the data they've accumulated over that past month. Yeah. And then there's an improvement. There's a creativity. There's an inspiration. There's all that stuff. I think what the AI tool is just going to elevate that. And speeds that process up. And if you're a designer, a creative, you can use that as a tool, as a brush.
I think there's two kinds of artists that are out there, right? There's the artist that is creating an expression.
Yeah.
Right. They have something that's inside of them. They're trying to take it out of them. And I think there's always going to be artists that are doing that. But then there's professional artists. And the professional artists, those are the folks that are, they walk around the world and take, 30,000 photos and curate down to the best ones.
Yeah.
They're the ones that are, you can go to any sort of, like, go to your local Walmart, Target, whatever the mega convenience stores are. They're the ones that are creating the mass produced pieces of art that you can buy at the store for your basic decorations.
Yeah.
So what if the professional artists are gone?
Yeah.
Like, so what? Go create something. Like, what for me it's doing is it's unlocking the ability for you to create what you want. And because there's a relative parity between what the computer can generate and what the human can generate, what humans value is the story. Where did it come from? There's an emotional and historical significance to objects and art and things and words. So if you know that the piece of work came from a human, it becomes valuable. I don't care that the AI can generate and extend out Starry Night from Van Gogh. I don't care. Because that painting, I've seen it in real life. It is beautiful, and it was created by a wonderful painter, a wonderful artist. I don't care if you can reproduce it and create permutations on it. It doesn't bug me, because the original exists and the artist existed. And today and into the future, there will always be artists.
Yeah.
There always will be.
Yeah.
And it's like, and for me, it's like I can't create that kind of art. But I know I have a vision for some of the games and some of the experiences that I want to create. So I can take the things that I like and throw it into a prompt and have it spit out some images for me. And I'm like, that's amazing.
And that's, and also it makes us question what is art? Is art, do you define art from how art is perceived by the viewer? Or do you think of art from, how it's sold based on the story, or from what the vision of the artist is? So what is art? Honestly, I went to the Rembrandt Museum in Amsterdam, and I walked through it, and it was amazing. I had no idea. I didn't know anything about anything, so I just knew that there was this great museum to go visit. I didn't know who Rembrandt was. And I learned a little bit as I went, and there's some paintings that spoke to me, that I loved, that I felt, and a bunch of them that I didn't. And I understood that, you know, afterward, I went, it was through how I felt about the painting that I got interested in understanding what the, where the story is. And then I got interested in the artist. So, you know, again, what is art? You know, is it in the eye of the person who sees it, or is it on, you know, the salesmanship, or is it on the marketing, or is it on the artist himself? But so for me, at the end of the day, it's what is that, what emotion does it evoke in the viewer or in the consumer of that art? And I don't give a damn about what the, you can bring the story later, but good art doesn't matter whether it's made by AI or made by a real person. It's about how it made me feel, how it made me think, how it inspired me to, you know, to feel or to think. That's what I care about. I don't really give a, you know, thing about the story.
What I love is this idea that there are, part of Feel Good Fatherhood in this world is this acknowledgement that there are people that need help. And specifically, you know, when I think of the, 10 million households in the U.S. are food insecure. 6 million of those households have one parent earning 60 grand or more. That's well above the national average for income. So there's a problem. And one of the things that higher income unlocks for you is access to experience and aesthetic quality. And one of the purpose of capitalism is to drive down the cost of production such that the quality of the good increases at the same value. But if you want, like, you can't even buy a TV anymore that's 5 years old, like unless it's used, you know, like there's a constant increase in quality. And so there are two Van Gogh paintings in the world that are still private ownership, that until those families decide to donate those paintings, the world won't be able to see it. And what I'm really excited by is that when you were asking me, what is art? I was like, huh, well, art is derived from beauty and aesthetics. That's kind of like, if I was the pure term, art is beauty and aesthetics. It's expression. And there are things that are aesthetically beautiful. There is actual art that is beautiful, and there's actual art that is not. So there's that part. So there's a little bit of that piece. But what I get excited by is, in the same way that you can have the assistant that knows your calendar and knows where you want to eat and knows how to schedule and stuff like that, you can decorate your house how you want it to be decorated. Mm-hmm. You can create an environment that is evocative of who you are and what you believe and the images that you like, and just increase the overall aesthetic experience that you have surrounding yourself with beauty. I made these great fractal space cosmic images because I love the Carl Sagan and Star Trek beautiful world. And I look at them and I'm kind of like, wow, it's like way back in the day, there's a procedural generation. You can create art called demos based on mathematical formulae. This is the same thing. It's just now I can do it because there's a certain level of math I'm not good at, you know?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I was able to create and put in these prompts and have it generate these wonderful things that I don't know if they exist in the world, but they're beautiful and I love them.
Yeah.
And, but they came from me. And so in that idea, when I was saying that, like, you know, because of the history of it, I'm taking those images I created, I'm going to put them on a metal plate, and I'm going to put them on my wall, because every time I look at it, I'm like, that came from my mind. I created that. And that pride in, I've put something beautiful, I've built something. I want that to be accessible to everybody. I want 3D printing to work. There are certain technologies I want to just unlock in the world to just make everything better for everybody. Because if we do that, it's like, if the new standard is up here, you know, it's like, oh, okay, the new standard's there. And I feel a little bit like Marie Antoinette, a little bit of like, let them eat cake with art, but like, there's some other big problems in the world too. But just on that one piece of the, I can create a Van Gogh-esque image derived from his style and say, and maybe I don't like sunflowers. Like maybe I don't like sunflowers, but maybe I like tulips. I can say, and I like Van Gogh, and I can say, generate for me a vase with some tulips in the Van Gogh style.
Well, how about you? How about you reverse? How about you reverse the process? Where this is what I love about this whole exercise is that when you say I want the vase or I want the Van Gogh without the flowers, there is an element of like there's an emotion that you want evoked within you. Now, how about you express that emotion? How can you express that emotion? Or maybe even ask the tool, like, hey, I like this 5 pieces of art. What's in common? What are the emotions that these, even though, like, let's say you don't know how to articulate that emotion that Van Gogh gives you, how about ask the tool, what are the emotions that are evoked when someone looks at the Van Gogh painting? And then ask the tool to create art that will evoke that emotion. You know, I mean, isn't that crazy? It's just like, now it makes you think, like, you know, it makes you think to the goal. Like I always ask this, you know, ask my kids, my wife all the time, what's the goal? What's the goal? Whatever it is that we're doing, whatever conversations we're having, whatever interaction, whatever, anything we're doing, I'm going to ask, what's the goal? And it's a very simple question, but it's a hard question to ask because most people live their life without knowing what's the purpose, what's the goal, what's the final intent. So as we're talking about art, what is the final intent of that piece of art? Is it, I want to feel a certain way, or I want people who visit my house to feel a certain way, or I want them to perceive me a certain way, or I want my kids to learn to feel a certain way, or, you know what I mean? There's vulnerability and there's honesty in asking that question. And it's okay. It's okay to want to be perceived a certain way by having certain art on your wall and have people see it as they come in. That's just a message. That's a way that you want your people to feel about you. And it's fine. Everything is okay. We just want to understand so we can be helpful. You know, what is it, make the tool helpful. So if you can express to the tool, what is the emotion you want to evoke out of yourself or out of your kids or your wife or you want to make your wife feel a certain way. And you feel like she's maybe have a screen that can have different arts at different time. And then based on what your wife's mood is and you want her to feel, you know, happy or joyful or positive or, you know, hopeful. And then you can display art that way for her. I just love going this one layer deeper because the tool allows you to do that.
I love it. I think not only do I think that that paradigm for Feel Good Fathers is a great paradigm to have, to think about what's the goal, what are you actually trying to create here? Take another step, go a layer deeper.
Deeper.
But I know that you're instilling this to your kids, and I think that this is a really great lesson for not only am I thinking about it as I'm going to be introducing my daughter to this world, but also because her first foray into AI art was to create puppies. So
yeah,
you know, yeah. And to that pursuit, I love it. Jay, my friend, if folks want to get a hold of you, how can they get a hold of you?
I'm available in all the social networks from Twitter to Instagram to Facebook. It's the same tag as @JayBourgana, and I'm happy to help.
And Jay, just since we didn't get to introduce you, what is it that you do and how can you help people?
Yes. So I'm a business investor. So I buy businesses. I fix them. I turn them around. I help grow them. And I help